It is with heavy hearts that we gather today to say goodbye to yet another friend. To a son, a brother, an uncle, a father, a co-worker, and a buddy to many. I am Blair McDonald, and this is my wife, Sherry. We are friends and classmates of Lenny's.
We would first like to express our condolences to Lenny's family, to Bud, Bev, Lori, and Linda, and their families, to Darian, Hunter, Phoenix, and Tricia. We are all here to support you now in your time of need and offer you the strength in the days to follow.
Welcome, extended family and friends, to the celebration of life of our buddy Lenny. Today we want to give thanks, we want to remember, and we want to take time to celebrate Lenny, his many attributes, his achievements, his successes, the endless goofy stories, and to talk about how much of a role he played in all of our lives and in the community.
Due to COVID-19, the family has made the difficult decision to select some of Len's closest friends and, of course, his loving family to attend the service today. For the hundreds of other friends, acquaintances, and co-workers, macaws are videoing, which is being live streamed as we speak. I believe it will also be available after the service as well. We must note that in different circumstances, like no COVID, this place would have been packed wall to wall and out the door. Lenny touched many people, and his friend list was bigger than anyone we know. I would like to read a poem which we felt was suited for today. It goes like this. Lenny, we are here to celebrate your life and the measure of its worth and every single life you touched while you were here on this earth. We wish to pay our last respects, that's why we are all here, to thank you for your friendship and for all the memories we hold dear. It's been a privilege to have known you, we, your family and good friends, and we will carry you in spirit until we meet you once again.
Leonard William Graham was born on April 25, 1965, in the Turtleford Hospital to the proud parents of Bud and Bev Graham. Affectionately known as Lenny, he completed their family of three and proudly took the position of the only son. Lenny passed away on December 29, 2020, in his home at Turtle Lake, surrounded by his beloved son, Phoenix, niece Sydney, and friend Colton. Lenny was 55 years old.
Lenny is survived by his two daughters, Darian and Hunter Graham, his son, Phoenix Graham, the mother of his children, Patricia Graham, his parents, William and Beverly Graham, his sister, Lori, her husband, Trevor, and her husband, Trevor Kostiak, and their son, Kyle, and his wife, Kelly, and their son, James, Lenny's other sister, Linda, her husband, Brian Letwin, and their daughters, Janelle and Sydney, and her friend Colton, as well as other extended relatives. Lenny is predeceased by his grandpa and grandma Graham, his grandpa and grandma Bonner, and many uncles and aunts. Lenny as a child. Lenny was no problem to raise, especially as a young lad. He was a good kid. He was happy, content, and well-tempered. When he was a baby and toddler, his older sisters were thrilled to have him around and were always paying him lots of attention. Bev tells us they adored him.
In later years, Lenny and Linda were in charge of milking the dairy cows, along with many other chores. Bud remembers how they would spend most of their time squirting all the thirsty barn cats instead of filling the milk pail. Linda and Lenny were only a year apart, so they were naturally very close.
Lori and Linda both have very special memories of Lenny. He was a good dad, he was a very good dad, uncle, and brother. Lori remembers one time they were home for Christmas and as they were gathering to leave, she noticed that Lenny had no coat. When asked why he had no coat, he simply said he had friends over the night before, and he gave his coat to a friend without one. They made sure Lenny left the farm that night with a coat. Lori added, "This was just who he was, always giving and never asking of anyone. I miss him so much." Thank you, Lori, for that memory.
Lenny loved living on the farm. He loved the space to do whatever he wanted. There were so many adventures. Once he decided to teach the farm horse how to go faster. As they slowly trudged through the trees, Lenny leaned up and grabbed a tree branch. At the same time he reached up, the horse sped up, leaving Lenny hanging from the tree. I'm not sure who learned the lesson here.
Bev has fond memories of Lenny and his friends, often Ron and Greg coming for beer and pizza after hunting and visiting with them. Lenny loved going to his hunting shack. It was his man cave, so to speak. He was thrilled when Darian and Phoenix both expressed interest in hunting and wanted to hang out with him in the shack. Bev believes that this was one of his favorite places to go.
Lenny always had time for his parents, too. He would come out for a visit sometimes, have a beer, and then he would be off to go visit someone else. Bev said his phone was always going off. She marveled at how many people were always contacting him. Everyone just wanted to be with him. Lenny was a fun uncle. In the more recent years, he visited often with his niece Sydney and her friend Colton. Together with Phoenix and Uncle Lenny, they shared many laughs and experiences at the cabin at Turtle Lake. As Bud told us, Lenny worked hard and he played even harder. Then Bud chuckled, and that really reminded us how much Lenny resembled his father. Lenny started school in Spruce Lake and joined us cool kids in Turtleford when he was in grade 4. I remember when Lenny first moved to Turtleford. He was a scrawny, smart-mouthed little shit. All of us Turtleford boys wanted to punch him out. In the first week of school, Lenny and I got in a wrestling match. I would pin him to the ground, confident that I had him down for the 3 count. Somehow, he would slither out, and before I knew it, he had me in a headlock. Within a few weeks, Lenny fit right in with the boys, and we became best of buddies. Lenny played all school sports. He was a natural athlete. It was always fun to be on his team and never a dull moment. He also played baseball, hockey, in which he was our goalie, and actually a pretty good one, too. Bev remembers him getting a Player of the Game award on a day where he must have stood on his head in net.
Lenny took part in all school activities and was always a character in class. I don't remember a day going by without laughing at something goofy that Lenny had said or done. He was everyone's friend, and as a friend, you could always count on him. Lenny was a good student and smart. Throughout much of high school, Lenny remained on the honor roll, which made his parents super proud. Bev remembers Mr. Tisch saying that the class of 1983 was his smartest class he taught. We totally agree with that.
You know how you meet a person and wonder if they'll ever find their way? Well, in a way, some may have thought that way about Lenny. Some wondered if he would ever get married, have a family, you know, take that next step.
As with everything else he accomplished, Lenny proudly became a father on December the 13th, 1997, when his beautiful daughter was born, Darian Mel. Then another bundle of joy arrived on September the 17th, 2001, Hunter Jean. And lastly, his mini-me, Phoenix William, was born November the 1st, 2003. Lenny chose the first names of all his children, and he made a conscientious effort to be involved in all of their activities, sports, and school events. He coached Phoenix hockey, drove the girls to their figure skating competitions, was involved in all the carnivals, taught them how to drive, hunt, fish, and how to have fun. Lenny's children were his world, and he took that role extremely serious. He worked hard to ensure they all had a vehicle, gas in their tanks, and insurance paid. They wanted for nothing, and Lenny made sure of that. He didn't miss any of their firsts. It wasn't uncommon to have Lenny cooking up a meal or entertaining his kids' friends or just hanging out visiting or doing whatever they were doing. He loved his time at Turtle Lake, taking the family out on the pontoon boat, fishing, and having fun.
Lenny encouraged family time. In 2009, they traveled to Disneyland, where they toured the family to SeaWorld, Legoland, Universal Studios, the zoos, parks, and all the touristy must-see places, and they even swam with the dolphins. Lenny didn't want his children to miss anything. In 2012, they traveled to Puerto Vallarta, Mexico, with the family, where they also went ziplining, toured a pirate ship, and took in all the resort activities. One evening, with the encouragement of his family, he entered the Macho Man competition, and of course, Lenny, he won. Those Mexicans really should not have underestimated that skinny Canadian boy as he danced his way across the stage, threw back a couple shots, dropped for a few push-ups, and ran around kissing all the ladies in the crowd. The kids laughed like crazy over this.
In 2015, Lenny took his family to Los Cabos, Mexico, where they went parasailing and again had a memorable and eventful vacation. Lenny was truly in his element, hanging out with his kids and making sure they were enjoying their vacation. Lenny at work. Lenny turned 16 and got his first, his only, and his final job at the Trollford Co-op. He started working part-time as a student in the year 1981. He was quick to learn the ropes and learn all the areas of the Agro Center, in which seemed like no time. He soon became that one employee that customers looked for when they needed the best service. Lenny was respected and looked up to by his co-workers and the entire community. This coming July of 2021 would have marked 40 years of employment at the Turtleford Co-op for Lenny, another accomplishment he would have been very proud of. Some of his past co-workers commented to us that Lenny was just one of the best that would go above and beyond to help all customers and staff. And another said, working with Lenny made the co-op a fun place to work. Lenny was so familiar with all the co-op departments that he even managed his own human resource details. There was a time that Lenny granted himself a leave. Now, I'm not sure if it was a personal leave or vacation leave or just sick days. Anyhow, the manager at the time, every day, would come to Lenny's department and ask his co-workers, "Any Lenny today?" In which they would reply, "Nope, not today." This went on for a few days. Now, don't get us wrong, Lenny was extremely responsible and committed to his job. So no doubt, he had cleared it with someone prior to. Eventually, he would always show up. It was all good.
The co-op thoughtfully sent us the following words about Lenny. Lenny began his career at the Turtleford Co-op on July 1st, 1981. He started his career in the original downtown store, as was the way with Lenny in many different positions. He performed everything from customer service to fixing tires, delivery of ag products, and even as a backup fuel driver when needed. He eventually ended up in the agri department, where he became the go-to guy for many customers and staff alike. There wasn't much that Lenny didn't know about or that he couldn't find. He was an invaluable asset to both the co-op and to many customers. He led our fertilizer team and helped train many agro staff. He outlasted many department managers and a few general managers as well. He truly became the fabric that makes up the Turtleford Co-op. A few people had the luck to have worked with him, and a much greater number of people had the privilege of calling him a friend. He will be greatly missed. Also, the general manager, Lawrence Winerow, included his words. "I have not known Lenny for very long. In the time that I have been employed by the co-op, I've come to know Lenny as a dependable and hardworking individual, extremely dedicated to the co-op. What I've also known is how he loved his family, how proud he was of what they'd all accomplished. Many, many people liked him, and he will be missed. His passing will leave a gap in people's lives that will be very hard to fill.
And Clayton Schmolle sends us his memories. What I will remember and miss the most from working over 30 years with Lenny will be his willingness to stop and talk to you. He was always able to provide humor or an understanding word when needed. Lenny was always on the go. He never did anything half-heartedly. It was always, let's get it done. I will miss hearing Lenny ask me, how is it going? It being our pension plan performance. As both Lenny and I were longtime employees, we seemed to be discussing this almost weekly. Lenny's passion for and stories from the things he enjoyed, whether it be his outdoor activities, the Montreal Canadiens, or his children, will all truly be missed.
Cindy Balzer writes, I will miss his laughter and joking around, his willingness to help, how passionate he was about the things he enjoyed, and his nicknames for everyone. Gary Turner tells us, the things I will miss is Lenny and I would see each other and yell, Lenny, him back, Gary. And when it was time to go for a smoke, he would say, time to go take inventory.
And from Shelley McMurphy, who shares her memories with these words. I started working for the co-op almost 17 years ago, back when we were in the old store. But I've known Lenny for longer than that. I remember when we first moved into the new store, the power kept going off every time a storm rolled through. We would sit at the agro counter with nothing to do. One powerless day, I grabbed the membership list and started quizzing Lenny on people's co-op numbers. I would say a number, and he would tell me who it belonged to. We soon had a large number of staff leaning on the counter, amazed at his memory. He knew 85 of the 100 co-op numbers I had given him. He was always ready to pitch in and help. One cold morning, minus 42 degrees Celsius with the wind chill, he came out to help me with a paper jam at the printer on the gas kiosk at the card lock. The paper was jammed in there fairly solid, and we had to take it apart, and with a screwdriver, pry out little pieces of paper. It took forever. We had to take off our gloves to get at the little mechanism. It was a miserable job. I kept apologizing for keeping him out there. No problem, Shelley, he kept saying. We're going to get this done. One day I was going for lunch, and because we were short-staffed at the time, I asked Lenny when he was taking his lunch break. He said he couldn't because he had no staff to replace him. I told him I would make him a couple of sandwiches and bring them back with me. Needless to say, I was a little intimidated because Lenny had legendary sandwich-making skills. It was an art form for him. The condiments had to be put on in a certain way. Vegetables cut a certain way. I nervously came back at one and handed him two ham sandwiches. I guess I passed the test. I miss seeing him every day in the winter. His laugh, our talks about the latest episode of Curse of Oak Island, and us sharing our frustration that they still haven't found the money pit.
We'd like to thank the management and the staff of the Turtleford Co-op, who we should mention have respectfully closed their doors for the afternoon today in honor of Lenny. Later in the years, Lenny had the opportunity to branch off and start his bin building business. Lenny was known throughout the countryside as the go-to if you needed a bin built or fixed. He often did this on his days off and on his own time. He counted on lots of his friends as part of his crew, such people as Ron, Wheels, Garrett, Blaine, his nephews Austin and Dakota, and many others took their turn working with Len over the years. One time they were working at Maqua, and Blaine had just got back from the mine up north and phoned Lenny and offered his services to Lenny. Lenny told him, yeah man, just come on up. We can use your help. We've got 6 bins to do and we're about half done. When Blaine got there, They weren't half done. Actually, they hadn't even started yet. Instead, Lenny and his crew were half in the bag, in the middle of a poker game, and Lenny just laughed, tossing Blaine a beer and told Blaine to catch up. Later, the bins were all completed in time, and just like Lenny had promised. Lenny with his friends. Lenny was instrumental in labeling most of us with nicknames. In our time, there was a buzzard, a spaz, a bum, a willow, a mongo, a wheels, and a sperm whale, just to name a few. Did you know Lenny's nickname originated from his neighbors, Glenn Hall and Bruce Marsh? On the school bus one morning, Lenny was beaking off, squirming and slithering around in the bus seat because he could never sit still. Glenn and Bruce looked at each other and thought, yes, this kid now will be referred to as Lizard. Who knew that name would stick after all those years? Lenny had fun wherever he went. He loved adventure and was game to accept any invitation. He loved Turtle for the best, I think because it was familiar and he was comfortable here. He knew someone would always take care of him, if needed. Through the years, though, he spread his wings and took in a few memorable trips. One of his first excursions was a trip to Florida with some of us classmates in 1985. There was Lenny, Lyle Knowlton, Terry Chambers, Neil McNabb, Larry Nelson, and myself. We took one of Dad's old vans, loaded it up, and headed off to the Edmonton Airport. Oh, the stories I could tell about that trip. We were just a bunch of young country lads, thinking we were really doing something big. Terry Chambers remembers, Blair, I was thinking this morning about our trip to Florida. On the last day, we were swimming in the ocean, and I cut my foot. I had to get stitches, and when I got back to the hotel, I couldn't walk. Lenny gave up his last night out on his vacation to stay with me at the hotel. That was just the way he was, to put himself out for his friends, and he had a lot of them. Not like the rest of you assholes. You guys could have left me in the hotel room to rot. Thanks, Terry, for that memory.
When we were out at Bud and Bev's the other day, Bev showed us the postcard Lenny had sent to them from Florida. I would like to share his words. December 1985. Hello from sunny Florida. How's the weather up there? I hope it's cold. We haven't had a whole lot of hot weather here because of the clouds. It's about 75 degrees Fahrenheit. We went to Disney World, SeaWorld, and the Epcot Center the first 3 days, and they were great. The bars are nice, and we haven't got into trouble yet. Oh, Lyle fell out of the coconut tree last night. But he survived. See you in about 9 days, Leonard. Blair tells me that out of all of them, Lenny was the only one to send a postcard back to family. Later, he traveled to Las Vegas with Garrett and Rebecca, Jeff, Christy, and Tricia. And a year after that, they joined with Garrett and Rebecca again, Teddy and Christy, to Veradero, Cuba. It was here Lenny learned to play catchphrase. His misreading of the clues and them drinking the swim-up bar out of rum was certainly a recipe for fits of laughter and good times.
In 2017, they traveled with Tim and Sarah to Ixtapa, Mexico, where they soaked up the sun and spent endless hours in the pool and in their beautiful resort. In 2018, Lenny attended a wedding outside of Puerto Vallarta, Mexico, with Jason, Garrett, and all the other guests. Another great trip with many laughs, sunshine, and quality friend time.
At this time, I would like to read a letter from Garrett to Lenny. Lenny, for a guy that was so little, you will never know how big you actually are. From your small interactions at work to the late nights with your closest friends, you have no idea how big of an impact you had on people's lives. Your laughter and smile would brighten up anybody's day. You had too many friends to count, and I would almost have to book an appointment to hang out with you because there was a lineup of people waiting to do the same. You were athletic, intelligent, and hands down the most genuine human being I will ever have had the pleasure of being friends with. You did everything 100%. You never slacked, no matter what you were doing. Your love for your wife and your kids, friends, and family were unmatched. To have that much love and joy for everyone with some left over was an incredible trait that only a few people possess. We didn't deserve to have a guy like you on this planet, but speaking for everyone, we are very grateful to have had you for the short time you were here. I know Ron's death was hard on you. I hope you found your peace and get to see him again. I'm sorry I didn't get to see you as much lately, and I'll cherish every memory I have with you. I love you, Lenny, and I'll miss you. Garrett. Thank you, Garrett, for those heartfelt words.
Shortly out of high school, we think 1987 or so, Lenny purchased his first home, which is quite the big deal. We all thought, wow, Lenny was so cool. It quickly became known as Lizard's Place, and it had an unposted welcome sign. It was open 24/7 to anyone and everyone. It was the place to be, and if, as a kid, you took the step into one of Lizard's parties, you knew then you were well on your way up the social ladder. People ranged from 14 to 70 years old. Lenny did not judge. Rumor has it, his empties could take care of his mortgage payment each month, thanks to all of his guests. Today, Donna Spencer owns that same house. She told us that when she would think of holding any family occasion at her house, she always thought that it was too small. And she remembered Lenny saying, "That house can hold 96 people." He certainly would have known that. In 1996, Lenny was 31. He sold his little house and purchased their current home with his buddy Teddy McNick. Now they had a bigger house to entertain in. Eric Hegstrom, known to many of us as Wheels, or Uncle Wheels, as the kids call him, moved in with Lenny at that time. He enjoyed Lenny's company so much and was so comfortable, he stayed for almost 15 years. We would now like to ask Uncle Wheels to come up and say a few words.
Hello, everyone. I guess I'm here to tell you a few stories about Lenny. Everybody knows there's a lot of stories to tell. He should have written a book. He could have made millions. This story is about 20 years ago. I've known him for a long time. We were playing Raiders hockey one night, and I got a puck in the face and broke my teeth. So the very next day, I had to go to the dentist, got my teeth wired, and I got a couple root canals. I was living with him at the time, and it was a weekend, so we happened to have a get-together for some reason. Not that we ever needed a reason to have a get-together. I got home and told him, "Well, I can't drink tonight. I'm on painkillers." Of course, then he said, "Oh, what's a couple of drinks going to do? You'll be fine." So instead of listening to my dentist, my actual dentist, I listened to Dr. Len. So then, much like an episode of The Hangover, I woke up on the living room floor staring at the ceiling. Then Len was there looking over top of me and said, "I guess I was wrong. You should have listened to your dentist." He always had he'll always be remembered, but he'll never be forgotten. Another story was we were partying at an old road one night. Lots of people were there. It was at night, so we rolled the bale onto the road and lit it on fire. Not sure whose bale that was, but he probably wasn't very happy. We were talking one minute, and the next minute, then he fell headfirst into the bale. I pulled him out, and he only had one word to say: "Hot." Of course, that was a Saturday night, so then on Sunday, and everybody knows Sunday was the go-to man if you had needed anything from the co-op. He was the only one that would ever answer his phone. So Glenn Simpson's phoned. He said, "I needed some parts." He said, of course, no problem. You can come over." Okay, so Glenn comes over. He takes one look at him, and half of his hair was singed off the side of his head, and his head was still black and red. And Glenn said, "What the hell happened to you?" And to which Len replied, "Oh, you know, roasting marshmallows got out of hand." I'll miss you, Len. Thank you.
Lenny was an active member of the community. He was quick to volunteer or help whenever he was asked. On April the 20th, 2000, Lenny joined the Lions Club and played a large role in recruiting at least 8 new members over the years. He served as club president twice and secretary once. He has helped with many community projects and fundraisers. He loved to take part in the golf tournaments, and as with many events Lenny was involved in, there was a story to remember. He will be missed as a valued Lions member. We would like to now invite Tim Millard up to share his memories.
Some of you may be wondering why I'm wearing this ridiculous hat. Well, this hat, this came from one of our Lions District golf tournaments. At one time, this was a yearly event that many of us Lions look forward to, but none of us more than Lenny. Sure, we enjoyed the golf, but it was more than that. It was about going away for the weekend with friends, goofing around, and having a few drinks. And of course, with that, Len, that also meant making new friends. But this hat, well, this is Len's hat, from Shell Lake. We arrived the day before the tournament, as we usually did, settled into our room, played some cards, probably checked out the local establishment, and likely laughed ourselves to sleep. The next morning came earlier than it should have, because Greg couldn't sleep. And apparently, if Greg doesn't sleep, no one sleeps. Since we were awake hours before any of our tea times, we decided to tour around town, find a bite to eat. We soon realized nothing was open, so we stopped at a gas station and asked one of the locals if there was somewhere to get breakfast. He pointed us to a tiny secondhand store and said, "They have the best breakfast in town." Well, he couldn't be wrong. It was the only breakfast spot in town. We had breakfast, took a look around at the local treasures in the store. That's where we spied a couple of gems. Len and I wore our hats all weekend, playing golf, and seemed like they brought us good luck. Him and I played together that tournament and several other in these hats, and we were unbeatable, or so we thought. My hat? Well, unfortunately, my hat is gone. The memories are not forgotten. You, my friend, you may be gone, but you will never be forgotten.
Thank you, Tim, for that memory. As mentioned earlier, as a student, Lenny was an athlete. This carried on throughout his adulthood. He played ball with the MT Blues. He was an integral part of the Mervyn Raiders. And I have a Raider story. He once called his team together, piled in the green van, picked up Mike Fay on the way to what Mike thought was a game in Edam. They all took their equipment. They were playing poker and having a few pops during the detour trip around by Glasson. After a few drinks, Mike said, "So are we playing tonight, boys?" Lenny said, "Hell no, just a boys' night out." And remember, they took their equipment. The evening took a few twists and turns, having something to do with chasing rabbits through the field in the van on the way to Edam and on the way home. The score was fun to fun. Lenny was also an avid golfer, with a natural swing, and was a supporter of the Mervyn Golf Course. Hunting was also a big part of Lenny's life, and we're also going to add beer darts and beer pong to this list, as Lenny always thought they should be Olympic events. He, along with Phoenix, held season tickets with the Saskatchewan Rush lacrosse team the past 2 years, and he also attended many Saskatchewan Rough Rider games throughout the years.
The Montreal Canadiens, hands down Lenny's favorite hockey team. Many of you have paid tribute honoring Lenny by posting the Montreal Canadiens emblem on your Facebook. I'm sure he's up there thinking that some of you will no doubt convert to the better team now. Lenny's first trip to go see his beloved Montreal Canadiens was with Blaine McDonald and a couple of other buddies in Edmonton. Blaine recalls that it was a bit of a runaway and, like so many adventures with Buddy Lenny, packed full of laughter and shenanigans. They were dressed in their jerseys and Santa hats, which looked quite innocent enough. But as the evening progressed, for some reason, the security guards felt they needed to be escorted out of the Coliseum to watch the third period from another establishment across the street. They went without incident. Every year in playoff time, and if the Canadians made it that far, it was not uncommon to see Lenny's jersey of his favorite team hanging from the living room window, showing his fans support.
Lenny's features. We would be remiss if we didn't talk about some of Lenny's quirky features. Lenny's ability to fall down. He was sometimes like a fainting goat. When he got to a specific alcohol level, he would totally lose the use of his legs. Even though he was an athletic guy, he would always go down face first. His arms would go straight back, and he would break his fall first with his chin and then with his forehead. Amazingly, he would jump back up and say, I'm all right," even though he had blood dripping off his nose and the biggest raspberry burn you would ever see. Many of us remember a time when we were all haunted housing. This is where we would go with a truckload of people in the country, in the dark, to find an abandoned house. We would sneak around these houses, hiding and scaring each other, pretending they were haunted. One time, at this particular house, Lenny went in first so he could hide and scare the crap out of all of us. Just as we entered the house, we heard a hell of a commotion. As we ran to his rescue, we soon realized that Lenny had fallen through the floor and landed in the basement. We yelled at him, asking if he was okay, when he replied, "I'm okay, man of steel." As we got closer, we shone the flashlight on him. He very quickly scrambled up once he realized he was laying right beside a dead porcupine.
Lenny had an extremely weak stomach, and he was never scared of a bet. Not a good combination. Of course, this only encouraged his crazy friends to give him dares. He has swallowed a live moth, taken a bite out of a roadkill garter snake, ate a minnow, and only God knows what else. And because of his weak stomach, throwing up was not foreign to Lenny. And this now leads to Lenny's partial plate stories. Lenny's partial plate. You knew Lenny was on a good party the night before when we all had to go looking for his partial plate. Oh, if that plate could speak, it would tell you, I've been on the street corners in Florida, floating on top of a coconut, in the tall grass on the back roads, in many porcelain environments, at sleepovers at party spots, sitting in a cup of vinegar, in the couch, on the floor, in the vehicle, in Jeff McNabb's mouth, and many others. But I was thankful my owner and his friends would always find me.
There was also the time Lenny was playing lawn darts with a group of friends when he threw his foot out saying, "Bet you can't hit my foot." And surprising or not surprising, that is exactly what they did. That was another trip to the hospital.
Or the time he was on a co-op trip to Ag in Motion and Lenny asked Cameron Simpkins to pull out his loose tooth. It was no big deal for this man of steel. He was quite comfortable to always entertain the crowd.
Then there's the story at Lenny's stag when we had him wrapped in plastic and duct tape and hooked him to the power hoist with his feet off the ground. I grabbed the power grease gun and stuck it down the front of his pants, then the back of his pants, and I think we all took our turns greasing him up. He giggled throughout the whole prank. We soon realized our big mistake. We let him off the hoist. For the rest of the night, he chased us down individually for a big greasy hug. We also have to touch on Lenny's creativity. Lenny's innovation and creativity were unique. Lenny had a Yamaha Skidoo that he rigged up with a padded bar chair strapped in for a seat and a set of straggly deer horns taped on the front. He took it on quite a few snowmobile rallies.
He purchased a moped so he could hustle to work. He could really go in that thing.
Lenny also found a deal on pocket bikes on the internet. and convinced all his buddies to buy one so they could all ride together like a big gang. They took off like a herd of chainsaws and ended up having to dodge the cops on a couple of different times. And one year, they were even the comic relief at the local fair.
Lenny also had a homemade convertible car that he proudly cruised around in.
But the best was when Lenny purchased a hearse, and he cleverly constructed a homemade wooden coffin in the back as a makeshift cooler for our beverages. This was a really good decoy from the authorities, and was well received by his friends, except for the time that he and his friends were coming back from a Halloween dance in Glaston, driving this vehicle. I think Lenny, Wheels, and Ethie were in the front seat. On their way home between Glaston and Fairholme, they came upon a rollover. Typical of Len, he stopped to help, forgetting he was dressed like a woman and driving a hearse. Needless to say, the lone occupant nearly shit his pants when the hearse pulled up first on scene. The victim had a broken nose and a possible broken arm. Len and the boys tried to get him in the back of the hearse to take him to the hospital, but there was no damned way he was going to have anything to do with that. Wheels let him sit in the front seat, and they transferred him back to his home instead. This is just one of the many stories of this hearse. He always joked with Darian about fixing it up for her. Painting it pink, installing a disco ball, or whatever she wanted. If she would have allowed it, he really would have done this for you.
Some of Lenny's favorites were, and in no particular order of importance, his homemade meat sauce piled on a plate of spaghetti, his Montreal Canadiens, the song Woe Is Me by Down With Webster, frying upside pork at the cabin with Phoenix, wings at South Bay, watching Breaking Bad with Phoenix, beer at the Turlford Bar, and of course, his family.
Since the 29th, there have been an enormous amount of comments, condolences, memories, and statements about Lenny on social media. In today's restricted times, it has been comforting to read, reflect, and remember the times and moments friends have shared with Lenny individually or with a group or gathering. He has been referred to as the master of laughter. Someone said life was so much more fun with Lenny in it. Another commented, today the world is a little less bright. Someone else said Lenny was an icon in the community. If you get a chance to view all the priceless photos that have been posted, they'll remind you how Lenny lived each day to the fullest.
Darian, Hunter, and Phoenix. Your father was a great son, brother, uncle, and friend. He was also a dedicated employee, but he was most proud of his accomplishment of being your dad. He loved you three so much, and you meant everything to him. Over the past week, you have acted as a team, and you have displayed such a mature role, looking out for each other, stepping up and putting plans in place that not many young people could have done. We as a community are here for you, and we want to offer you the strength to meet the days to come. Please know you are in our thoughts and prayers. We are grieving with you, and we are here for you today and in the days to follow. I know you will cherish the many memories you have shared with your dad, and that he will live on through you.
I am the mother of Len's children. What attracted me to Len was his laughter and his zest for life. He was always so fun, funny, caring, and generous. All I wanted was to be a wife, have kids, stay home, and raise my kids. That was my dream, and Len made my dream a reality. We had three amazing kids, and I was able to stay home and raise them while Len went out and worked his butt off for us. We never went without anything we needed. He always made sure we were very well taken care of. And for that, I will be eternally grateful to him. I honestly don't think I could have chosen a better partner. And together, we raised three awesome kids. We had the perfect balance. I was overprotective, smothering, and tried to be a bit more strict while he was fun, cool, and laid back. I quite often said it wasn't really fair that he was always the fun parent and I was just the boring mom, but that's just how it was. That's just who Len was. I would like to take this opportunity to thank a few people. First, to Blair and Sherry for writing Len's eulogy for us and basically gathering and preparing all of these speeches for today. I know for a fact, after Blair shared a conversation he had with Len, that we definitely chose the right couple to do this for Len. You have captured him perfectly. You took a huge load off my kids for doing this for us, and there are just no words that can explain how grateful we are to the both of you. You two are amazing people, and we love you guys for everything you've done. To Christy, who came flying the second I called and became my rock, I will never forget what you did for us. Sarah, Tara, Twyla, and Jeff as well. They dropped everything and came when we needed them. To Bev and Bud and family, I just want you to know that I think you guys did an amazing job raising an amazing man. Len and I talked this spring, and I know one of his priorities was to be sure to spend more time with the two of you. You are the best grandparents I could have wanted for my children. To Joel and the McCaws Funeral Home, your graciousness and expertise is greatly appreciated. You are so kind, helpful, and accommodating, and we appreciate everything you've done. To my family, I just want you to thank you for your endless support. You guys welcomed Len into our family. I know how close you guys got to him, and seriously, some of my family members love him more than me, but that's okay. We spent a lot of summers at the lake. Those memories will never be forgotten. He considered all of you family, and even in the last year, he still stayed in contact with all of my family, and that's just how he was. He loved you guys. To the first responders, RCMP, Marshall's Ambulance, first on scene, Sydney and Colton. Thank you for getting there as quickly as you did and for everything you did for Len and Phoenix. Phoenix, thank you for your quick actions and being so strong. I am so proud of you, and I know your dad would be so proud of you and how you acted under pressure. You did everything right, and you did everything you could have, and I'm very sorry you had to go through that. Thank you to the members of the Lions Club that were able to be here today to honor Len. Thank you to the co-op, Lawrence, and the staff and members for doing a write-up to honor Len. To this community, everyone has been so supportive and caring. We have had an outpouring of love and support, and we appreciate it so much. Someone sent a message to me saying, and made a comment that I had to share Len with this community, and that was certainly true. Everyone loved Len, and that made my heart happy. I made a post on Facebook, and I asked everyone to show love for Len and his Montreal Canadiens, and you did not disappoint. I know he would have loved seeing all of his profile pictures with the Montreal Canadiens. Thank you to everyone in this community and beyond. To his friends, especially the six sitting here today that are also the honorary pallbearers, Len had some of the best. You guys meant so much to Len. He never had a bad thing to say about any of you guys. So many times I'd be so freaking irritated that he would choose to go and have a beer with you guys or do anything with you guys. Sometimes I felt like I maybe wasn't on the top of his priority list, but I'm so glad he got to spend the time he did with you guys. And you each got to form a bond with him that will last forever. Life isn't fair. You guys have lost a couple of the best. Hold those memories close. And please promise me to always, always keep his memory alive. Always share his stories and share them with my kids. Because you guys know Len, the real Len, and I want my kids to hear all those crazy, ridiculous stories. Thank you for being here for us. We love you guys. Len loved you guys, and we always want you to be a huge part of our lives. To my kids, I know you get sick of hearing this from me, but I'm never going to stop saying it. You three are amazing. You kids planned this celebration for him. I know it was stressful, it was hard, and it's unfair, but you did it, and you did it perfectly. And I'm so ridiculously proud of you guys, and I know for a fact your dad is smiling down and is so proud too. He's always been so proud of you guys. You three were his whole world. Everything he did was for you three. I'm so grateful that you guys got to spend the time you did with your dad. The fact that you had your family pictures taken not too long ago, and that you were able to spend this past Christmas with your dad. Phoenix, you and your dad were inseparable this past year, and I'm very happy about that. You are all so close with your dad, and you each had a special, unique bond. And I hope you know how much he loved you, and never forget how much he loved you. I promise to do my best to fill his shoes a little bit, even though they're pretty big shoes to fill. I love you guys. The last few messages I shared with Len were at Christmas time. We wished each other a Merry Christmas in the morning. In the afternoon, I thanked him for the gift he had bought me. Later, he messaged me and thanked me for the gift that I had bought him. That night, I was sitting on my chair in my living room, kind of pouting, because Len and the kids were together, and I just knew they'd be having fun. They always did. And even though the kids were with me Christmas Day, I was always just a little bit jealous, because I knew when they were with their dad, there was laughter and there was fun. I started typing out a message to him, and I was going to thank him for being such a great dad. And I was going to tell him how thankful I was for him for being such a good dad. But the thing is, you guys, I deleted that message. And I didn't send it because I was pouting. Now I know he knows he was a good dad. And that I thought he was a good dad. And I especially know that he knows the kids thought he was a good dad. But if I can give you any advice, it would be that if you love somebody, if you want to thank someone or have anything positive or encouraging to say to that loved one, send that damn message. You won't regret sending it, but I promise you, you will regret not sending it. Len, you were an amazing dad, husband, and friend. This is how he wanted to be remembered. And I promise you, you will always, always be remembered that way. Along with everyone that knew you, I will love you and miss you forever.
The family has prepared a slideshow in honor of Lenny, which we will now watch, followed by a Luke Bryan song that we will listen to during our moment of reflection.
Cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not. Cause the drinks bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Toast to the ones here today. Toast to the ones that we lost on the way. Cause the drinks bring back all the memories. And the memories, bring back your. There's a time that I remember when I did not know no pain. When I believed in forever and everything would stay the same. Now my heart feel like December when somebody say your name. Cause I can't reach out to call you, but I know I will one day, yeah. Everybody hurts sometimes, everybody hurts someday, yeah, yeah. But everything gon' be alright, gon' raise a glass and say, yeah. Here's to the ones that we got. Cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not. Cause the dreams bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Toast to the ones here today. Toast to the ones that we lost on the way. Cause the dreams bring back all the memories. And the memories bring back your. Memories bring back your. There's a time that I remember when I never felt so lost. And I felt all of the hatred was too powerful to stop. Oh, yeah. Now my heart feels like an ember and it's lighting up the dark. I'll carry these torches for you, and you know I'll never drop. Yeah. Everybody hurts sometimes, everybody hurts someday. Yeah, yeah. But everything gon' be alright. Gonna raise a glass and say, hey. Here's to the ones that we got. Cheers to the wish you were here, but you're not. Cause the dreams bring back all the memories of everything we've been through. Toast to the ones here today. Toast to the ones that we lost on the way. Cause the dreams bring back all the memories. And the memories bring back your.
When I got the news today, I didn't know what to say. So I just hung up the phone. I took a walk to clear my head. And this is where the walking led. Can't believe you're really gone. Don't feel like going home. So I'm gonna sit right here on the edge of this pier and watch the sunset disappear. And drink a beer. Funny how the good ones go too soon, but the good Lord knows the reasons why, I guess. Sometimes a greater plan is kind of hard to understand. Right now it don't make sense. I can't make it all make sense. So I'm gonna sit right here on the edge of this pier and watch the sunset disappear. And drink a beer. So long. And watch the sunset disappear. And drink a beer. Drink a beer. Drink a beer,
Lenny's passing has left a hole in all of us, in the Trofford Co-op and in the community in general. Lenny was only 55, but experienced so much more than the average person. He was just a simple country boy with a gigantic heart.
It has been our honor to be a part of Lenny's celebration of life. He was truly one of a kind, who gave us so much and took so little. He held his family and his friends with such high regard, and was available anytime, anywhere for anyone, always. That is just the kind of guy he was. He will be truly missed. Until we meet again, my good friend, you will never be forgotten.
This will conclude the celebration of Lenny's life. We are hopeful we can gather later this year in Lenny's honor to share many more stories in person, when we can raise our glasses in a toast to our friend, Lenny.
Me, I'm so woe. See me decked out from my head to my toe. Woe is me, I'm so woe. Everywhere I go, I'm a one-man show. I feel like a Hollywood star. Handful of pills, all black car, rock guitar and 10 shots of whiskey. Got a chain on my neck and a massive hickey. You say you're a big deal, big deal. I've been a big deal ever since Big Wheels. Shit's real, I feel like a supermodel who just skipped a meal. I like to party and spend my dough. And when I go to rehab, I'll put it on a show. And it's so spectacular whenever I rap to you. Cause I'm reenacting my feelings to capture a moment like a Nikon. And when the mic's on, I'm a star, baby, I'm your icon. And put on the light, I shine, I glow. And woe is me, I'm so woe.
Say woe. So see-through, not you. No, you think I don't hustle, I do. Used to get up for the bus, now I fly through. Drive by you, I'll buy you. I'll write, then I'll bite your style. I try to act like a child. Born yesterday, but born to be wild. I cheated to get what I got.
stepped all up and you sat for my spot. I bet you I'm winning, I bet that you're not. I bet you don't sin and I bet you get caught. You just leave the talking to me. I'm dope and I'm hot on my feet.
I'm the S to the H, the I to the T. And what you don't know, you just gotta believe.